Sri JayLakhani, an excellent communicator of Hinduism in Britain and director of the Hindu Academy, the Vivekananda Centre in London. Over the last 15 years, Sri Lakhani has given talks on Hinduism to thousands of youngsters at English schools, colleges, and universities. If you wish to get a glimpse of the modern, dynamic face of Hinduism, then do not miss this series of talks.
In Hindu religion, they say everything happens by the will of God. It's lovely stuff. We love all that. We all love it. They say, Mr. Lakhani, in that case, why should we bother with religion? Why should we not be just laid back? Everything is happening by the will of God, so why are we? We are pointless. What's the point of making any progress whatsoever, even in the religious field? Why should we bother? Very pointed question, imagine. And my answer, you'll like it as well, is this. Didn't I tell you, you are God. So when you exercise your free will, that is the will of God. So everything happens by the will of God. When you think, I want to interact with this world in this manner, that is the will of God. Exercise your free will, because you are expressing spirituality in your life. You see, at every instant of time, we have this opportunity, I'll do this or not do that. If we lost that free will, we would rather die. That keeps us going. Don't you see, that's your spirit percolating through. It makes you want to stand up against nature and take decisions. Take decisions, wrong or right, take decisions. You are God. So free will and the idea of a God doing everything is reconciled through this idea. You too are God. Don't worry, madam, go for it. Exercise your will. And recognize the potency of the will. It's actually all these things that we have. Look, another interesting thing. This religion, this Swami Vivekananda who inspires me, said something very lovely. He said, do you know, the real search of humanity to resolve the human condition, not even searching for a God, that's a ploy. The real search, do you know what's the real search? The search is for freedom. We want to exercise or experience freedom. We wish to break free from all shackles. The shackles of the body and the mind and the intellect, we want to break free from it. It's for freedom is the goal. That's what we are searching for. And we're using all this thing called religion and gods to reach that. Because when you think of God as super personality, you want to build relation, go near and say, oh Lord, I'm here, oh I'm here. Do you know why you are doing it? Because you know that when you are there, you will be free from everything, including your desires that kind of keep clouding you. Even your desires will drop off because you're fulfilled. Now you're with God. So the idea of really, if you like, this thing that we call freedom, why is it important? Because in a way, stirring up your, showing up your spiritual dimension. Saying that is what you're searching for, freedom. I wish to break free from every shackle. And the only way you do that is to rise above the idea that you are the body and the mind. You are the spirit, pristine and pure. Once you experience that, what desires, what limitations? I can move about like the king of the universe without any desires for any aspect of this universe. That's what the masters did. First, let me touch on yoga, because again, this is experiential religion. You see, in this tradition, we have come up with an experiment. We have placed in front of humanity saying, look, this idea that you are essential nature of the spirit, you may not believe, you may believe, doesn't take you very far. Even if you intellectually sit down and drink cups of coffee and say, I work it out, yes, it must be real. It doesn't take you very far. You must touch it, touch base with it. We give an experiment to try out on yourself. If you fail, then you can come and say, this is all nonsense. You put an experiment in front of you. Try it on yourself to see if this is for real, religion for real. All this idea of spirit and eternal soul is for real. Come face to face with it. And this experiment is called Raj Yoga. Now, the word yoga means joining together with your essential nature. You know, when people say, what's the closest relationship you can have with anybody? You say, well, you can think of somebody like God as your father in heaven. That's one relationship. You can think of God like your mother in heaven, another relationship. You can think of God as your friend in Hindu religion. You can think of God as a child. You can cuddle. You can think like that as well. All this allowed in Hindu religion. But the closest relationship you can have with anybody, says this religion, is with yourself, your essential self. You seem to have lost sight of your essential nature. Rejoining with your essential nature as a spirit is the journey, is the idea behind it. That's called yoga. Rejoining with your essential nature, rediscovering your essential nature as a spirit, not what you are caught up with. This is called yoga. And it's done very simply. First of all, he'll tell you this. Suppose, you know, you tried it, I'm sure, to meditate. And you see, you sit down, you close your eyes, you're doing your best not to, you know, scratch your back and everything. You're trying to sit still and hold yourself still. It's marvelous stuff. You're trying to hold yourself still. And in no time, you find that your mind is in a whirl. Do you know what actually happens when you sit down to meditate? You discover how disjoint, how kind of, you know, what a mess you are. That's all it happens. That's why you become agitated and come out of the meditation. Yeah, it was very good. And he said, oh dear, it was not good at all. I don't know, it's kind of whirling away, you know. And there's not, I couldn't hold my mind still for a moment. So when we sit down and try and still our body, and hopefully try and still the mind at the same time, we really discover how bad we are, how our mind is in a huge whirlpool and doesn't stop. So only thing that happens at the beginning of meditation is you discover how bad you are or how badly your mind, mental structure is. That's all you discover. So the first aspect of yoga is this, is saying, look, before you are ready to sit for meditation, get your life in order. Unless your daily life is itself structured and ordered, there is no way you'll be able to sit down and still your mind. There's no way. So first requirements of yoga is that in your daily life, there are certain disciplines and observances you must take up and incorporate them in your daily life for many years before you are ready to sit down. Because otherwise your mind is going on like that. And the aim of yoga is very simply this. Look how simple it is. This is Patanjali Yoga Sutra. The second and the third aphorism captures whole of yoga. The second aphorism says, yoga simply means holding the mind still. Can you just do that? Just hold the mind still. Because when you hold the mind still, immediately, the moment you are able to do that, even for an instant, you suddenly discern yourself with the spirit and not the body and the mind. You see, I'm separate from the body and the mind. The moment you can hold your mind still for an instant, do you know why we get spiritual glimpses and these free samples? Because while we are doing some routine activity, for some reason the mind becomes still for an instant. Then a greater reality was reflected in it. You don't conjure up a god, you don't conjure up spirituality, that's nonsense, it's an invention then. You don't conjure up, you discover it. And the way you discover it, the moment your mind is held still, even for an instant, you get a glimpse, you say, wow, you rise above your limited vision about yourself. That's why you see a tremendous oneness with whole creation. You say, ah, and that's the experience. Just hold the mind still. But here, this is the easy part, this is the theory. Putting into practice requires many lifetimes of hard work. So the prerequisites are tough. Once you do the prerequisites in your routine life, then when you close your eyes, with a snap of a finger, you can enter the state of meditation. This is the idea of yoga, real yoga, not a gimmick. And the disciplines that are imposed on you are very severe. I just show some of them to you. You shudder and you'll immediately leave me straight away, I know. But that's fair enough. The disciplines are called Yama Niyama. Yama means five disciplines. Satya, Ahimsa, Asteya, Aparigraha, Brahmacharya. It's saying truthfulness. And then the final one, a little bit skip over the others. Final one says Brahmacharya. I'm just going to touch on two of these and you see how tough it is. The first one says, unless you start establishing yourself in being truthful. You say, what do you mean? We are all nice, honest people here. We don't cheat. No, it's not that. It's much more severe discipline because it is insisting that what you think is what you say and what you say you do. You must be meticulous in that. Very stringent. You say, but we are like that. Oh, no, you are not like that. Sometimes you meet somebody and say, oh, nice to meet you. And say, oh, dear, not him again. But you know, you're thinking what you're saying. But the moment you say the truth, you will lose that person forever. So it enforces that what you think you say. And that doesn't stop there. It says what you say you do. You're establishing truth. How do you do that? Suppose I told you, I'm going to see you on the 17th of January at the temple. And suppose I get ill. I should not say make claims like that. So through carelessness, through diplomacy, through all these things, we fritter away our ability to be established in truth, become careless. It's not because I'm intentionally untruthful, but I'm careless. So it's insisting, no carelessness. Continue to be stringent about what you say you're established in truth. What you think you say bluntly, and what you say you follow through, even if it kills you, you follow through. Because you said this has happened, this will, you do it then. That means you are at least joined up inside. So this, even though you say, what do you mean by truth? I say, don't worry about the philosophy. What do you think true? Just follow it through. So whatever your idea about truth, make sure you what you think, what you say, and what you do are joined up. Once you do that, your inner structure becomes very strong. You become highly integrated within yourself. That gives you tremendous strength. Just one idea, truth. Establishing truth. And the final one, satya, ahimsa, asteya. Ahimsa means non-harm, don't harm living things. Ahimsa, asteya, aparigraha. I won't go into detail because I won't have the time. The final one is the killer. That's why I'm bringing it out. Brahmacharya, brahmacharya. Brahmacharya says, in simple English, no lovey-dovey. You say, no lovey-dovey? This is getting difficult here now. I've got a very good relationship with my partner. It's a very steady relationship with a partner. Surely loving relationship within two partners should be encouraged in religion. This Patanjali says, nothing doing. No lovey-dovey. You say, this is terrible. No lovey-dovey at all. Not in your dreams. Not in your dreams. This is getting out of hand here. Why? Are you spoil sport? No. You want to rise above the idea you are this body and the mind. Do you think you can possibly succeed if you are chasing after other bodies? This gender attraction is perhaps the most powerful thing that makes us relate to our physical being. Gender attraction is the most exciting thing that we can encounter, gender attraction. It is telling you have to give that up. Oh, no, I can't give that. That's my life. You see, then you see, you won't rise above the body consciousness. You want to rise above the idea that you are the body and you are chasing after another body? How do you think you'll succeed? Contradiction in terms. You want to rise above the idea that you are this body. How dare you then chase after other bodies? It's an insistence, brahmacharya, and people immediately abandon me straight away. I don't blame them. This is the only thing going for us in this life was, you know, we look at this image and we get a ticklish feeling, and this fellow saying, stop all this. There's no way. Let it be. I'm not going to compromise. And Patanjali wasn't going to compromise. If you are serious, you want to experience yourself with the spirit, you must rise above the body consciousness. And the thing that will make you strongly, the greatest physical pleasure we get is through gender attraction. Now, you're saying that, look, this in a way ties you down to the idea you are the body. You want to rise above it. You have to give this up. It's very difficult to give up. You know what happens? Some people say, what happens? This is a magic happens. I say, this is what happens. When you're able to rise above the idea that you are this gender attraction, you can stand up against this force of gender attraction. Forget about the amount of confidence it generates in you. You can stand up and do anything you like. You stood up against the most powerful natural force. You stood up against it. You say, no, I'm going to fight you. The moment you're able to stand up against it, the confidence it will generate in you will allow you to access lots of things. You get tremendous, the self-confidence itself will take you further in your spiritual journey very fast. It's very difficult. But it's,
It seems to me that that's one road, but what about the tantric road, which is also in Hinduism? So I'm just kind of...
You must explore.
I'm not against
No.
Saying, I'm interested in how.
How do you reconcile?
Together.
Reconcile in the following
how many
way.
Degrees between them?
180 degrees. Let me. There's 180 degrees. Why? Let me tell you. Remember, I said, in a very, without perhaps elaborating too much, every disciplined human endeavor will lead you to spirituality. Now, the tantric yoga is considered to be a left-handed pathway. No, you're talking right and left handed. It's considered to be left handed pathway in the sense that yes, you can get spiritual experiences even through that. But watch it, my friend. You'll end up by nothing but having orgies and so on. You'll lose track. Because the idea is this. You see, because we possess all these powerful faculties, if you can become one pointed in the process, that one pointedness is what you are achieving, what you are aiming for. So even through that process of gender attraction, you become one pointed, you'll hit the jackpot. But the problem is called left-handed pathway because for 100 people who try, well not 100, say a million people who try, one will get through. The rest are having just going down the tube. Because they become end up by thinking they are nothing but, you know, the quivering animals. They turn into quivering animals. They are not supposed to. You are supposed to rise above the body consciousness through that process of tantra. And one will succeed out of a million, but the rest are lost. Take into account your own ability or inability. So if suppose you feel that gender attraction is something that you cannot get over. Don't force it on yourself because you become a psychotic case in no time. You become a nuisance. It must come from within, that the energy comes from within to say, I'm going to stand up. If you impose it artificially, in no time you become a psychotic case. You'll become weird. So rather not go down that path. That means it is your pace is different. You are not ready for it yet. So leave it alone then. When the time comes, it will come naturally from within. Then you will be able to master it. Don't impose it artificially because it will become counterproductive to your journey. Do it at your own pace. Don't force it. It has to come naturally. So again, this is an interesting. Anyway, talking about yoga, what's the aim? Basically, I said, if you hold the mind still, and this is for this, as I said, you go through all these disciplines. I didn't even mention the next five because I think we'll be running out of time. Once you manage to establish yourself, and then when you sit at the drop of a hat, because you now mastered your daily life, you know how disciplined you are, you tell your mind, oh mind, hold still. And when the mind holds still, through all these disciplines and hard work that you put in, through many lives perhaps, the mind holds still for an instant. And during that instant, this thing that kind of made you feel strongly intertwined with your body and mind, those knots are broken. You are able to free yourself and see your experienced self as a spirit. All these ideas you heard about religion, God, eternal soul, become real for you. Then you talk of religion from experience, not from book learning. Then you become. You see, let me tell you the conclusion of yoga. He says at best, through this process, you lead a disciplined life. At worst, you lead a disciplined life. At best, if you succeed, you become the prophet of humanity. You become the prophet of mankind. Because you are talking of religion from experience. So the aim of yoga, however hard is the pathway, the destination is grand. It's giving the greatest prize human beings can have, their experience of their essential in the spirit. So this is the gem at the end of the journey. And suppose you fail, so what? We chase after worldly things and we fail anyway. Haven't we noticed? We all finish up, broken up and shattered. So instead of doing that, you kind of hit yourself in this difficult brick wall, and so what? But at least you lead a disciplined life. So yoga is something to recommend, but not to enforce on anybody. It's something that must come naturally from you. Out of all the sciences, the most pretentious, means the most arrogant science, is called physics. Because it tells the rest of them, you all come to me, I'll sort you out. When it comes to the nitty-gritty, the fabric of reality, you come and sit at my feet and I sort you out. You biologists, you chemists, you engineers, even the social scientists, you come and sit at my feet because I tell you the heart of the matter, the fabric of reality. We know that. It's called physics, the most pretentious of all sciences, most arrogant. Let it be. It's basking in glory, but in its true dignity. You know why I'm saying it? Because I'm actually a physicist. The real reason. My background is physics. I studied physics at Imperial College and did masters under somebody very famous called Sir Roger Penrose. He's very famous. He's one of the key people on quantum mechanics and, you know, all these black holes and all that. He's this marvelous fellow. So I come with the right pedigree of science. So when I talk science, I'm not talking, you know, some hippie science from some weird university. I'm talking of mainstream science. So please bear in mind that I'm not presenting anything as hippie. It's really as mainstream as you can get. This is what I'm going to present to you in the next few minutes. In physics, the most exciting thing they discovered in the last 100 years is not even nuclear power and all this G particle. That's all kind of by the way. That's kindergarten. The most exciting they've discovered since the middle of 1920s is this idea of quantum. Now, this word is becoming very popular. It comes in science fiction, it comes in all sorts of things, and it's everywhere. They use the word quantum. I think they're selling some washing powder is called quantum as well. Let it be. This word is getting everywhere. Because it's a popular word. It seems magical, mystical word. What is it? Let me, in simple English, explain to you what they've discovered and why they feel rattled by it. The whole system is rattled, and this is the heart of physics. This is not the periphery. This is heart of physics, of all physical sciences. We are dealing with nuclear power, or you're dealing with any, you need to come to quantum. Everything has to come to quantum. Even gravitation, you have to come to quantum. You have to resolve things in the name of quantum. So what is this quantum god, new god, quantum god? What is it? Big one. This god is really sweetie. This god they've discovered at the heart of science, heart of physics, heart of hearts. He's saying, my friends, in fact, the fathers of quantum mechanics, Niels Bohr and Werner Heisenberg, have kind of put it in lovely, simple English. I think Werner Heisenberg said, this is what you discovered, and this is not negotiable. This is a terrible thing to say in science. This is final. They're saying, if you ever thought, you can explain this universe, I'm putting in simple English, in terms of sticks and stones, or smaller versions of sticks and stones, you know, these little particles called atoms and nuclear and protons and neutrons and quarks, they say that is a myth. That is a, just like we were projecting God, and we say it's a myth. You say, oh dear, this is terrible. We thought we were relying on this chap. This atom is a myth. This is what science is telling us. It's, if you like, a ploy to get our minds around nature of reality. The underpinning to this world, look at the language. The underpinning to this reality, which we are so sure about. Look, I'm sure about this. I'm solid. It's all solid stuff here. It's a lump of matter everywhere. The underpinning to this reality, says physics, the physical of most physical sciences, underpinning to this reality, we are guaranteeing you, is not matter. You see, then what is it? We call it quantum, they say. And we know the mathematical formalism we can use to kind of get around it. You see, we don't want the mathematics. It gives us headache, especially my daughter, she gets headache with mathematics. We don't want this mathematical formalism. We want to ask you a blunt question, what is it? And the fathers of quantum physics say, look, when you come across the quantum phenomena, and if you don't start feeling dizzy, that means you not understood it. Because we are feeling dizzy. We, the people who discovered, feel dizzy. What we are discovering defies every approach we have, every linguistic ploy we can put to try and understand it. It defies all our abilities. It makes us shudder. All the major mature physicists have recognized and paid tribute to it. Like Richard Feynman used to go to every university and say, oh, chaps, come on, what is quantum? And not a single hand would go up. He said, you don't know. Nobody knows. The reason is this. What physics has discovered at its heart is essentially non-material. The only language they can say is not matter, guaranteed not to be matter. But they will not allow the word spirit to enter the realm of physics. They say, oh no, Jay, the only spirit we understand comes in mortals, not this spirit. Keep away from us. At the heart of matter, at the heart of physics, we discover essentially the underpinning to this reality is spirit, not matter. But then you say, how do you explain that? How is then becoming like this? They say, don't ask. How that turn into this is the biggest quandary. They say, don't ask. How this thing becomes appeared as this, we don't know how the transition takes place. This is called wave collapse theory in quantum. We don't know. Don't ask.
What was that called?
Wave collapse. Wave. Collapsing. Wave collapsing.
Wave.
A wave. Wave collapse. So they say wave collapsing and becoming. They say this is just an appearance. Matter is an appearance. Reality is non-material. That is reality. Matter is a paradox. Language of physics. You say, this is terrible. You suddenly disappeared. These were not. Now, then you say, no, but give us some kind of physical interpretation regarding nature of reality. They say, this is what we can give you. The link between quantum and reality. Quantum is defined as a mathematical formalism, which is defined by a psi wave, a wave, wave function. It's called Schrodinger's equation that produces waves. Now you say, what is waving about? We heard about water waves, you know, air waves, what is electrical waves? We know all these waves. What waves is this? They say, don't ask. I've told you, stop asking us silly, difficult questions. So you say, what is waving? What is wiggling? Look at how science comes close to religion. They say, do you know what's waving? Existence is shuddering. The wave is interpreted, the quantum wave that gives description to reality is considered to be a wave of probability of existence. Probability of existence is defined as quantum. So what quantum is saying is that what you see in front of you is nothing but existence shuddering. When existence, because existence is something that you say existence either exists or non-existence. No, this is some weird thing called existence shuddering, variation in existence, and that is appearance. This is the world that you live in. Do you know how I look? You'll be touched by this. This is a metaphor I've developed. I'm going to use it again. And I use it at physics at Imperial College. I say, imagine you had I'm trying to produce quantum in the most simplistic language I can. Imagine a whole block of transparent jelly. If you look through it, you'll go right through it, you'll see through it. You can't see the jelly because it's transparent. You just see through it. So a whole block of jelly, you see through it, oh dear, there's nothing. If I give it a little smack on the side, and the surface of the jelly, the surface of the block, you see waves being set into motion. Waves and waves interacting with other waves. And the whole thing becomes real. I say, I can see it. This is what this reality is all about. The spirit shuddering. And when the spirit shudders, creation comes into being. So what was non-material appears as matter. The waves are visible. The underpinning is always going to stay invisible because it is like that. But the apparent level, at the level of appearance, the whole creation comes into being. So all we are saying is, shudder of existence is this creation. And do you know why I can say that? The esoteric definition of the spirit in the Hindu tradition, esoteric definition, Advaita definition is asti, bhati, priya. The spirit is called asti, bhati, priya. You say, what's that? Existence. Asti comes from A-C-E-T. From asti, Sanskrit asti became A-C-E-T and then become A-C-E-T, it became existence. Existence is the underpinning. Shuddering of existence, what you see the world. Asti, bhati, the second word is lovely, I'm going to touch on it straight away. Consciousness. It is of the nature of existence, of the nature of consciousness. And the third one, priya, it is sweetie. It is very endearing. It is very, very sweet. This is the spirit. Existence, consciousness, and sweetness. This is the underpinning. Now, how did consciousness come into the universe? How do you reconcile consciousness with quantum? This is what Roger Penrose is writing books about. Again, a beautiful thing. Look, just as I took you to the physical of physical science and physics and brought out quantum and said, this is a shuddering existence, shuddering spirit in front of you, appearing as this crass matter. In the same way, when you look at neuroscience, has progressed dramatically in the last 50 years. Dramatic, they can tell, even if you're dreaming, they know which neurons are firing. They can actually pinpoint each and every neuron that's firing when you're dreaming. They can trace it. Powerful mechanism. But if you ask the neuroscience, what's your heart? Because you all have a heart. Like in physics, the heart problem is quantum. The heart problem in neuroscience is the problem of consciousness. They are pulling their, just like the physicists are pulling their hair out to make sense of the quantum, in neuroscience, they're pulling their hair out, trying to understand consciousness itself. What is the seat of consciousness? Where does it arise from? And they say, we don't know. We don't know which slice of the brain seems to produce it. It seems to be everywhere and nowhere. Transcendent and imminent. I said, tell you, this is language of science, spirit, not science. Oh no, don't ask us, Mr. Lakhani. It seems to be everywhere and nowhere. Consciousness. And this question continues to puzzle the neuroscience because they're saying, we don't know. This is a very thrilling thing, but we don't know how to address it. The only thing they've done so far is to generate vocabulary to try and explain it away. But just producing word doesn't mean you explained it. Let's give an example. Let's say consciousness now is a modern kind of idea, is short-term memory linked with awareness. You say, awareness now, what is awareness then? You just transferred it. You don't answer it. You just invented new vocabulary or jargon of, you know, language words in order to hide the issue. The issue is, what is consciousness? What is it that gives me access to reality? What is this consciousness? And they say, oh, Mr. Lakhani, just a brain function. Come on, grow up. Basically, you say neurons firing, electrical and, you know, chemical activities in the brain firing away, producing this buzz called consciousness. Nothing more to it. Deal with it. Live with it. It's just a brain phenomena. I said, no, it's not. It is, they said, Mr. Lakhani. Suppose we come and put anesthetic in your system. You'll go, they see your consciousness gone. It's a bodily thing. Or suppose we don't like, come with a hammer and hit you in the head. Your conscience will go. I told you it's in your brain. I say, no, it is not. Let me give you another metaphor to get around this problem. It is not produced by the brain. Let me give you a metaphor. I'm very good at that. Suppose a young child come into the room and he found the dimmer switch and start playing with it. He goes one way and the lights come on. He goes the other way, the lights goes off. The child will come to the conclusion that the switch is producing electricity. You can't blame him. He doesn't know this is just a conduit of electricity, not the generator of electricity. In the same way, the brain is a conduit of consciousness. It doesn't produce consciousness. It allows flow of consciousness. So you can interfere with the switch. Somebody can hit me on the with a hammer and break the switch. doesn't mean it's hit consciousness.